And I had just gotten out of jail the week before.
But I tell you what.
Now that makes him even more interesting.
Yeah.
Well, I got the reward because I just found him here in Cumberland, Maryland. Yeah. He was on the escape. We're taking him back.
I'm a fugitive.
And Donald Trump is going to be coming out and taking his boat back.
Yeah, I'm going to help him build the beachy wall.
Okay, that song we've been listening to, one of my favorites, Let's Dance, from the end of 1962, and it was the top of the charts at the beginning of 63. Now, you have to remember 1963, the most unusual year in rock and roll, because the number one song in January of 63 was from the British Invasion, Telstar by the Tornadoes.
Yeah.
Summer of 63, we had Sukiyaki by Kayu Sakamoto, number one from Japan. It was totally in the Japanese language. We didn't understand it, and we just dropped the atomic bomb on them 18 years earlier. But now we're buying their music. And at the end of the year, the number one chart, topping song for the rest of the year, for 5 weeks, was in French by the singing nun, Dominique.
Dominique. Wow.
But amidst all of that, we had some great hits at the top of the charts, and one of them was by my buddy standing next to me.
That's me.
That's him, Chris Montez. We know him as Chris Montez. But Chris, your given name is not exactly Chris Montez.
No, my given name is Ezekiel Christopher Montanez.
Montanez. Yeah. And every time I see him, he always shakes my hand and says Montanez, as opposed to Montez. Montez is a stage name.
Yeah,
Montez
right.
is the name that's on the records, but everybody knows him as Montanez.
Yeah. Okay. Because they cut from Ezekiel, Christopher, they cut Christopher to Chris and Montanez to Montes.
Oh my gosh.
So that's how I said, and believe me, I felt uncomfortable with that name.
And as a matter of fact, you really don't use that name unless you're on stage, right?
Yeah. I my real name, everyone in high school knew me as Zeke.
Yeah.
So that's what my wife calls me Zeke, my family calls me Zeke, and they don't call me Chris Montes.
And that's when you're back in Southern California where you grew up.
Yeah. Or people that I know that hang with, you know.
What was it like growing up in Southern California when you were just starting with the music? Now, what year was this? What year did you graduate from high school?
64.
That you were going to high school with some people that we've heard of, right?
Oh, yeah, those hoodlums.
Hoodlums?
No, they were. It's funny because there was Brian Wilson.
Now, Brian Wilson from the
Beach Boys.
Beach Boys.
I'm sorry, yeah,
okay.
Brian Wilson. And we became friends because I had Brian Wilson in one of my classes, you know, a couple of classes at Hawthorne High. And then Carl and Dennis, you know, they were right behind him. Brian Wilson was, I had him in my English class, I had him in my history class, and we were just regular kids that they, Brian Wilson liked that what was the name of the harmony, the four-part harmony.
Oh, yeah.
It was always in.
Yeah.
And so he'd always, when I'd go over his house, I'd go and jam with him, and he'd be on a keyboard organ, and Carl would be on drums, and Dennis Wilson was part of the Beach Boys, and Carl was a rhythm guitar player. And they were such wonderful people, you know.
And you sang with them?
And we jammed together. We'd do some rock and roll. You know, we didn't have any music then, you know.
Yeah.
We'd do Johnny B. Goode or whatever was hip at the time, because remember those, like Chuck Berry, they were the innovator of rock and roll, Little Richard, Chuck Berry,
Jerry Lee Lewis. Johnny B. Goode, Roll Over Beethoven, all that great rock and roll, pure rock and roll music.
Yeah, okay? Yeah, pure rock and roll. And that was the foundation of rock and roll because, you know, they got the people moving. And one time I was over there practicing with them, and Dennis says to me, "Hey, Chris, you like malts?" And I'm an ice cream freak. I love malts. So he says to me, "You want me to make you one?" I said, "You can make one?" He said, "Yeah." He pulls out the blender and starts making this vanilla malt. And I thought it was a special way to make malts, but he says, "Here's the secret," and he throws in a couple of teaspoons of malt. And I never knew that. And he makes me this one, and he gets it. Wow, it's a delicious malt, and now I learned something.
So you went over there then for the food instead of the music?
Both,
okay.
No, I wasn't expecting that. It just popped into, you know, his mind, and he was such a wonderful guy. All of them were.
Now, are you playing music in school? You playing music in church? Or you just playing music after school with the guys?
After school with the guys, you know.
Now, what are your parents saying to you? Chris, get out and get an education. Chris, don't be playing that rock and roll. That's nonsense.
My mother and actually never said anything. She knew that I was dedicated to going to school and was going to get my diploma.
How many kids in your family?
There was 18 of us.
You had 17 brothers and sisters?
Well, at the time, before I was born, pick up on this, and only 9 of us survived. So my mother was maybe 16 when she got married. And my father was a little older, maybe 22 or something, or 20. I really don't know. And so I ended up with 4 brothers and 4 sisters. And, you know, they got married young, they got involved. My brothers all got married, getting a regular job and raising their wife, whatever, you know. And my sisters got involved and got married.
So where do you fit in on...
I'm at the last of the boys.
You're the last of the boys?
Yeah, and I had a younger sister. So to make a long story short, none of them got their formal education. They just got married and decided that was part of life, and, you know. And I didn't feel comfortable with that because I go to my friend's house and they had nice homes, you know. I always say to them it was like a Rick Nelson home, nice furniture.
Yeah.
And mine, I lived in a little shack, you know, crooked sofas and, you know, slept on the floor a lot, you know. And I decided I don't want to be like this. I want to be like them. Something's happening and I've got to get an education. I didn't know where the education was going to get me, but it made me feel proud that I finished.
So you were recording then on your own while you're in high school?
Yeah, well, I did a demo. I was playing with some guys, right? We played garages and practice, and I decided to make a demo, so I wrote a couple songs called She's My Rockin' Baby and Forgive Me. I still have the masters. My brother found them. Listen to this. He found those masters or those demos in the closet after my mother passed away. He'd been in the closet for maybe 35 years, 40. I said, you got it, you kid, you found it. So I had him transfer, and now I could sell the 45, you know, the CD.
You got it. Them.
And I listened to it, and I say to myself, who is that kid? Who is that person? That's not me.
Yeah,
you know, it's unbelievable.
Well, that was in the developmental process to become Chris Montez. That was you for a time.
That yeah, that was who I thought I was. I thought I was cool, you know.
Well, I think you're cool now.
Well, I thought Zeke was a cool guy, you know, leather jacket. And you know, it's funny, when I was in junior high, there'd be a corridor and there'd be a... It's funny because I reflect on this. There'd be the lockers, lockers. And I go, and there'd be these girls, a lot of girls, standing by the locker room. And they'd be like this, hey, Zeke, how you doing? Hi, Zeke, you know. And if I didn't say hi to them, they get nasty.
Is this after you were recording?
No.
Or was it before you
recorded? This is before I even, you know, even got into music, really. And it was, I don't know what it was.
What was the name in high school?
Hawthorne Intermediate.
Oh, junior high school.
Yeah, junior high school. Okay. So, you know, it's like, okay, I'm sick of this. You know what, you know, I have to always be polite, and I wasn't. I love the girls, you know, but it wasn't like, I'm just a person. If I don't talk to you, you get mad at, like, if I'm some kind of a stuck-up artist or something. I wasn't even close to that. So I decided to make a demo, and my brother's wife took me in the car, because I didn't have a car, you know, as a sophomore, and I had no money, and I saved up, like, $25.
Big money back then.
It was a lot of money.
It was an investment.
I don't even know. I just saved, you know, and I said, and so the guy, the engineer, says, okay, you ready? And I came in with my drummer and my rhythm guitar player. And so I start singing these songs, you know. She's my rockin' baby, you know, this kind of stuff. That wasn't one of the tunes, you know. And I only had a half hour. And I said, I listened to playback, and I said, can I do that again? He said, yeah, do it again. So I did it, and when I liked it. It was fine. Get on with the next tune. I did the other one. And then he gave me this, he made me a plastic cut of which was like a 78, I guess, you know. A piece of metal covered with plastic, and then they cut into it, you know. And so I went home and I played for my mom, and then it was kind of nice, you know. And then one day when I'm coming from school, I used to come and watch the Dick Clark Show every day. You know? American Bandstand. American Bandstand was if you were on American Bandstand, the whole world saw you.
Oh,
so
yeah.
She says, these people, I came home one day from school, and she says to me, these people keep asking about you. They keep calling about recording you and wanting to talk to you about recording. I thought, wow, you know, what is this? It was a shock, but it was a great shock, you know. And so I sort of asked her, what are you talking about, Mom? She says, these people keep calling, they want to record you or something. So I said, okay. And my mother never spoke English. So she got the interpretation of numbers.
Right.
Really?
Uno, dos, tres, cuatro, sí. Seis, a six, a seis, okay.
So in the house, you never spoke English?
Not very often. And then, you know, not with my mother and my father.
Yeah, the kids.
My brothers did, yeah. They, you know. She got the number right, and I called them and said, yeah, we want to talk to you about, you know, we heard your music and we like interested in recording.
Who are you talking to?
I was talking to Barry DeVorzon, which was a big producer then. He produced a lot of acts like Johnny Burnett, Dorsey Burnett. And if you don't know that, you can
Dorsey
look
Burnett,
it up.
Tall Oak Tree.
Tall Oak Tree, and Johnny Burnett was a... you're 16, you're beautiful, and you're not mine. So I called, and they said, yeah, we heard the engineer. Now, the engineers, usually they when they record you, they get rid of the tape, erase it so they can use the tape over again. Well, he didn't. He called these guys and said, hey, you got to listen to this. I'm assuming this is what happened. And so they got a hold of me, and that's how...
Now, didn't Barry have a hit, Barry and the Tamerlanes?
So I got together with him and went and started, Barry wanted to see me, and he helped me compose. So he gave me the structure of writing songs, right?
You never knew how to write a song before that.
Well, I wrote songs, but I didn't know about ABA, you know, two verses, bridge, and verse, you know, and having a hook, you know. So I knew, I just wrote what I felt. So one of the first songs we wrote was All You Had to Do Was Tell Me. He goes, and let's see if I can do it. You want me to do this?
Of course.
Okay.
Do you remember the song? I mean, it's been a long time.
I don't even remember what key I did it in. It goes.
I can't believe it.
All you had to do was tell me that you found somebody new. That's how it went, you know. Just so then that became a regional hit, and then from there we developed. And
now you did two versions of that, one by yourself and one with Kathy.
Yes, I had a good hit with that one, and then we were getting into other songs with the new producer I had. Monogram Records, Jim Lee, and he signed me, he wanted to develop me. And after I had All You Had to Do Was Tell Me, he decided to bring Kathy Young, and Kathy Young had her own hit. She had a song called A Thousand Stars in the Sky, you know, beautiful song, recorded with the Innocents.
And for the same Jim Lee.
Yeah, for the same Jim Lee, yes.
Before you do this, there was another influence in your life, a young man who died in a plane crash.
Oh, yes, yes. When I first heard this person by the name of Ritchie Valens, and when I found out he was Mexican, it even made it better, because I said, oh, there's a Mexican rock and roll artist. So I said, well, I have a chance, maybe, you know, get into this. And one day I went to see him at a little hop, and there was like 200 people, maybe less. And I'm waiting, they said, Ritchie will be out in a minute. And I got there late because I'm standing way in the back, and everyone's sold out, and everybody's waiting to see Ritchie Valens. So I'm standing in the back, and I said to myself, I get to hear Ritchie Valens sing Donna and La Bamba, and that's all I need. I just say, I was there. So I'm standing there, and to my right, I turn, and Ritchie Valens was standing next to me. This is God's blessing, I mean, he always. And I got to talk to him, and I said to him, you're Ritchie Valens? He said, yeah. And he smiled at me, and I said, wow, I wanted to say so much, but I got, you know, I was so shocked. And I said, you know, I want to be a singer like you. And he said, oh, that's nice. And he shook my hand, and then he went on. And then later on that year, 6 months or 5 months, he got killed. And I said to myself, if I ever become an artist that I'm known or have a name, I'm going to treat people the way Ritchie Valens treated me.
And that's why he's here with us today,
you know,
because he treats everybody this nice.
I just, you know, it's nice to be humbled, you know, and to see someone of such, to me, he was a superstar. And for him to be kind to me and give his time to me, you know, I have people run after me and grab me and say, we love you. I've been wanting to see you for 30 years, and they cry, you know, and they hold on to me. And it makes me laugh because I know what it is to be on that other side, to see say hello to an artist that you want to express your feelings for.
Did you ever consider going to Bob Keane for your musical career?
No, only because Bob Keane, I heard that he did Ritchie Valens real bad. Okay. His contractual thing was bad, so I never wanted, I didn't like the person because to me, he harmed someone that was a true artist.
In that day, back in the early 60s and late 50s, that was kind of the regular way of doing business, wasn't it? To take advantage of the artists. If you can get these young kids to perform for as little as possible and make as much money off of them as possible, you would do that.
Well, I don't know, because I wasn't into that business aspect. I was just a hungry artist, or became an artist because somebody said, "Why we want to record you?" And that's how I developed, you know, from a demo to a...
And all you really wanted to do was get on stage and perform.
Yeah, I just go and play at different places, you know, but I wasn't thinking about being any kind of an artist.
In fact, you probably would have got on stage and done it for nothing until you learned
you
could get paid.
In fact, I did a hop, like a talent show, but there was other artists there, or... you know, the local, and they had an open mic. So I said, "I'm going to go and, you know, sing my song, you know." And it was called Poor Give Me My Darling or something. It was a ballad, you know. So I have my brother, my oldest brother, who played guitar, and he was a little more fluent than I was on guitar. So he worked on this lick, and we worked on this lick. So and they said, "Okay, and now we like to present Zeke Montanez." So I come on, I'm positive. I'm here, you know, girls, and they're standing there. And I start singing my song, and it was called When I See a Girl. That's what it was. And he takes a solo. Dun, 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 dun. He's supposed to play this on guitar. Ba-da, 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 ba-da. And I say, "Okay, Nando, take it." And I turn around, and he's gone.
What do you mean, gone?
Yeah, he left me on stage by myself. And I said, and so I finished my song, you know, and I said, and he was a macho guy, Mr. Tough, you know. I said, "What the heck happened to you?" He said, "You didn't tell me I was going to be that close to the people," and my knees started bouncing, so he bounced off the stage. So that was my first comic act, you know, comedy act.
Jerry Lewis and Dean Martin.
Yeah, yeah. That's right.
But you did hit it big now with, in 1962, in October of 62, yeah. You did hit it big with Let's Dance.
Yeah.
How'd that happen? You didn't write it now. Jim Lee wrote it.
No, Jim Lee did it, yeah.
Did he come to you and say, "Hey, Chris, I got a song"?
Well, we were writing a lot. Most of the Let's Dance album, I wrote a lot of the songs, most of them. And we were writing together, and he said, "I got this idea, you know." And I said, "It's okay, you know." I didn't really care that much for the song, because I wanted to do a la Ritchie Valens, you know, mm-hmm. The ballads, sing to the girls. And next thing I know, we did this thing, and it becomes a hit. I mean, a big hit. All of a sudden, I got a whole new personality, like, you know, And I remember, it was thrilling. People say, "Whoa, that's a great song," and you know, it's like when somebody, how is it? They give you a trophy or something, or I don't know how to express it. It's just all overwhelming. All of a sudden, you're somebody, but I don't mean somebody in a, you know, I just like somebody knows who you are. And it's different than just being a common person, you know. We're all common, but when somebody puts you in the spotlight.
There's your personality, then there's your identity.
Yeah, there you go.
That identity became Chris Montez.
Yeah, right.
And you're standing there, Zeke, looking at Chris Montez and saying, I got to fulfill that mission now. I got to do what Chris is supposed to do. Let's go.
Right. Let's dance, you know. And I'm saying, wow, you know, this is unbelievable. So that became the whole premise of my singing, Let's Dance. And then from there, I did the Dick Clark Show, which Dick Clark is, like I told you, the only TV show to be on.
And you were on there twice.
Yeah, twice. I was on there twice. And I paid no attention. You know, it's time passes, and I'm grateful for the moment, but I got my life to carry on, you know. It's not, I was somebody or I like, I'm still that person. You know, every day you're a changed person to me. And from after doing the Dick Clark, they send me there in Philadelphia. The next thing I'm doing is the Howard Theater, all the black theaters.
The Apollo Theater, you're on the Apollo?
Yeah, I didn't quite finish it because I got there late, but then I carried the rest. But so I stood around and then.
Do you remember who was Smokey Robinson and the Miracles on the Howard Theater or the Apollo Theater with you?
Yeah. Howard, Jerry Butler, Smokey Robinson, Screaming Jay Hawkins. Screaming Jay Hawkins would do a whoa, spelling, you come out with this long, you know, vampire coat, and they roll him out in the coffin.
Get in the casket. Yeah.
Yeah, and they roll him out, and they say, wow, you know, what is this, you know? But these are the art kind of artists I got exposed to. And from that little venture of being first time around with the black artists, you know, and then I came to L.A. to do the shows, and I got kind of, I used to get kind of raunchy, you know, thought it was cool, you know, because he used to sing to the girls, and my manager said, hey, you got to keep tone it down. I thought that he wanted me to, you know, be cool that way. And so I wasn't real risque, but when I went with Sam Cooke, he, watching him sing all these great songs, Sam Cooke had several hits. If you ever change your mind, you know.
By leaving me behind.
Leaving me behind.
Bring it on home to me.
Bring it on home to me, and all of that. He had several hits, you have to look him up. And I learned a lot. And I remember we're doing all these like outside arenas. One time we drove up and I had to wash my face and everything in a dirty sink that, you know, the around where your football fields are, you know, just to get, you know, get freshened up, you know. And somebody said, hey, Sam is looking for you. And I said, oh, what did I do? Because during this period of going with the black tours, there was signs that said all over in the South, black and white only.
White over here, black over here,
yeah,
colored, right. They called them.
Yeah.
Colored.
Yeah, I remember saying to my parents, I wish they didn't have an in-between toilet, you know, it's just black or white only, because I go into black, they sort of get, the white, they think, well, he's a mixture of something, you know. But anyway, and so that, I got my first exposure to that. And
you're talking about traveling through the South.
Traveling
through the United States.
In the United States, yeah. Traveling through the South in the United States, and it was called, I didn't know then, it was called the Chitlin Circuit. And most of the blacks made their fortunes going to, it's like Las Vegas with several, you know, clubs. And it was, I remember being in a bus, and Tommy Rowe had it, he did some of these tours with me. He had Sheila. And several hits. And Tommy Rowe was a great influence in the rock and roll. We were good friends. We still are. I mean, we're like brothers. We hung out. I remember being on the bus, and they said, Chris, get down. And I said, what's that about? And they said, the people, we're going down to a middle of town, like a movie set, you know, where crowds are on both sides of the street, and they're watching this bus come in, you know, all these. And they said, no, they'll start throwing gas bombs at us or start throwing rocks at us, because they'll think we're freedom riders.
Right.
And that's the freedom riders with the whites mixing with the blacks to protest, you know, unity.
Yeah.
I come home from L.A. and they said, they want you to go to England.
Now, how many times have you been to England before this?
Never. I've never been out of L.A. Are you kidding me? L.A., I'm just, you know, four brothers and four sisters and, you know, nothing. So I go to go to England. So I had this guy on Sunset and Vine, Gentry's was, I remember. Gentry was the name of the clothing store, and he had a big beard like this, and he took care of all the artists, and he fitted me with a couple pairs of pants and a jacket which was like a collarless. Yeah, and he said, this is the in thing in England. I said, oh, okay, so you're set. So he sets me up, I go to England. And when I'm there, everybody's, few people said, wow, where'd you get that coat? You know, we haven't seen jackets like this. And I'm saying, wow, that guy told me I was going to be in, you know. But it turned around. So they said, we like your coats, you know, the collars and stuff. And then I met this group that was going to be the warm-up for the show, and they were called the Beatles.
I heard of them.
The Beatles, yeah. I don't know whatever happened to those guys, but...
So they were going to be the opening act for your tour?
They were the opening act for my tour.
Well, what did you think of them when you first saw?
Oh, I thought they were great guys. I said, a couple of places when we go to the different clubs, you know, before we got rolling, I see a lot of the British looking like them, or they had their long hair kind of thing. You know, they had that trip bangs, and they were like, it was a British invasion with them. They had their own thing going. The British had their old style going.
Well, this was before they invaded the United States.
Yeah.
This was in England.
This was in England.
Yeah.
So so the next thing I'm doing is, and they're the opening act, and I'm closing the show, and Tommy was in the middle, and everything's going great. We're getting mobbed. It's like the, you know, think of being so famous you can't go nowhere. you know, and after a while...
It happens to me, I understand.
Yeah, I understand. Well, I'm glad you understand. And I remember standing in the hotel and I say, hey, Paul, go out to the window. Because it'd be a whole bunch of crowd. And he'd go out there and they go, ah, you know, screaming. We tease him.
Oh, you or Tommy, you mean, went to the window? Or the Beatles?
Tommy didn't hang around with us too much. I hung out with the Beatles. And so I said, so they said, how about you, Ringo, go up there? And then Ringo go up there and they go, ah. And not you, Chris. I go up there and they go, ah, Chris Montez, you know. It was kind of funny because, you know, they're like a couple stories down, you know. And that was a joke. And
this was throughout the month of March.
Yeah, to the tour. Yeah.
You went to Bristol, you went to London, and a lot of cities in between, Liverpool.
Liverpool, yeah. I think we closed in Liverpool. The Beatles took me to the tailor, and I had some nice suits made. Oh, beautiful suits. I was like, the top of the.
Are you still with Monogram Records at this time?
Yeah, I was still on the tour. Then. Yeah. So they took, come on, Christopher, we can show you. And they're showing me around, telling me about England. They were excited that American artists came to hang out with them, you know. Tar liked the Stratocaster. They didn't sell them in England.
Uh-oh.
And so I had them play it. We played, we jammed a little bit. So when the tour was at the end, they became so powerful. And then they said, I hope you don't mind, Chris. We think we should, last couple of towns, they closed.
It was open. A show.
Yeah, Tommy. I said, it's great with me. I said, I don't want to close in Liverpool. This is their hometown. To me, it's you know, paid.
Yeah.
Patronage to someone, you know. And it could matter less to me who's headliner. After this venture, you know, I'm saying goodbye to the guys and we're, you know, saying our goodbyes. It was a great show. Because there was other people on the acts. I don't remember who the other, they were, had comedian and this and that. And so I said to them.
The Viscounts. The Viscounts,
yeah.
They were on there. Yeah.
It was a girl singer.
Yeah. Okay.
Anyway, I went to say my goodbyes to John and Paul, and they were talking to their tailor. And he said, hey, Chris, you remember? Yeah, how you doing? And I said, I just wanted to say goodbye, and if you sign this book. And they said, we're getting our suits cut like your coat. I hope you don't mind.
When they started wearing those Nehru jackets,
yeah.
It's because they were copying Chris Montez?
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, that was interesting.
I didn't know that.
Where the Meet the Beatles at Nehru cut?
Yes.
Yeah. And I said, well, I just took it lightly. I said, oh, that's cool. Yeah, okay. I hope you don't mind. He said, Paul said, I said, no, it's cool. Yeah.
Up until they became really the Beatles, they were following Eddie Cochran with the leather and with the sweat back.
Yes.
Okay. And then they followed Chris Montez with the Nehru. When they released their first albums in the United States, they're wearing the Chris Montez style.
Yeah. I remember distinctly when I thought it was a nice gesture.
Yeah.
I just said, yeah, it's cool, you know, like I'm going to wear the same kind of shoes you're wearing, and it's the same thing, right?
Yeah.
So we're going to cut our tailor and our coats like your jacket. I said, oh, that's cool. When I was on tour, they took a few days off. We had 2 days hiatus. And they came back and said, where were you guys? I said, we were finishing our album. And Paul and John come up, and we had a room to ourselves up there, you know. And they come, and Paul starts playing this LP. And she was just 17. I heard that whole album before it was ever released.
They did that album in one day.
I said, the 2 days that were gone, I said, wow. And I said, Paul, play that song again. And I had him, you like that song? Yeah. I had him play five times, you know. We're like hanging out, like you and I, you know, people hanging. So after the tour, I came home. And all of a sudden we got, you know, swamped by it. I used to sing this song called, you're the one I live and die for. And I used to get on my knees and sing to the girls in England. They'd be screaming. That was all from show, learning to be showman, I guess you want to call it. So when that tour was over, when the Beatles came to America, they said, we want Chris to come to the house, you know. And it was inundated with police all over and, you know, couldn't get in the Bel Air home. And they waited for me and got up. And I go in the house, you know, and Paul McCartney sees me, and he gets on his knees and he starts saying, you're the one, that's all, Paul, come on, oh, you're the one. He was a jokester. He was a funny guy.
That is
Paul
so
is a,
funny.
Was a humble, beautiful person. So was John. You know, in the middle of a tour, one time I was sleeping, and we were at a party, and I was burned out, because parties, after a while, it gets boring, you know. But I was just tired. I get, you know, I do my thing and want to just go.
Yeah.
And And so I'm sleeping in the bus, and all of a sudden I hear this ruckus, and they're coming in, and the guys, you know, and John Lennon pours a beer on my head.
Oh, I remember.
And I got up and I said, "You son of a..." And we got into it, and they broke us up. But that was an experience. So when I got my program signed by them, everybody says, "Long live the Queen." And Chris, it's nice working with you. And John Lennon writes, "Chris, remember Mansfield?" And that's where we got into
that's
it.
That's the beer.
Yeah. And I still have that program. People want to buy it. But, you know. But that was a beautiful experience.
Hey, so you come back to the United States.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, let's dance. That's over.
Yeah.
Now what are you doing?
Well, you know, I remember being at the... Hey, this is funny. I remember... Because I used to do a lot of surfing.
And you were a real surfer. Boys were not.
No, then big fact, when Brian Wilson said we're going to name ourselves the Beach Boys, I said to myself, the Beach Boys, you guys don't even surf. You know, Dennis was the only one that surfed. But I remember laying on the beach, and I just got back from England. I was kicking back, and I had a little phone radio, excuse me. And I hear, "And the Beatles have just landed." You know, screaming. I said to myself, and I said slowly in my little voice, I said, "Big deal. I just got through doing a tour with them. Big deal. You know, that's done. It's over with, you know." My connection was I knew the guys, and the guys will always be the guys.
You yeah.
know? I didn't even have a thought that they were going to be such a wonderful composers and, you know, great rockers. Because there were great rockers on stage when I was in England.
When you were over there, did you ever meet anybody of the other stars, the other English invaders, such as... Now, I know you did the Tony Hatch song, What, Call Me?
Yes.
And did you get that from...
No one. I didn't meet any of those people.
You never met a Petula Clark?
No. I just did a show with her, but Petula Clark
was... You just
did
a show with Petula Clark?
Yeah, on the boat. Yeah, on the ship, yeah. And she was wonderful. I helped her. I went on first, and then we were paired together, and I helped her on stage, and it's... And she starts playing these songs on piano.
Yeah.
I didn't know that she had a classical musical background in stage. So she's doing all this stuff, you know.
She plays "I Want to Hold Your Hand," doesn't she? Still play that?
I don't know. I just let her go,
oh,
you know.
Man.
But it was a wonderful, and we drove back together, and it was she was real kind to me, and we talked.
She
was beautiful.
Sweet lady.
Yeah, sweet lady, yeah.
Oh, I love her. Yeah.
Yeah.
This big tour is mm-hmm. over. Mm-hmm. The big hit rides the crest of the
mm-hmm.
wave.
Mm-hmm. I had another one called Some Kind of Fun that sort of hit. In England was two or three, and in the States, I don't know, maybe. And then I realized that the contractual agreement that I had with my manager and owner of the company was cheating me. Not only cheated me, but was cheating me.
You're talking Jim Lee.
Jim Lee. Turned out to be a real bad person. So I was so disillusioned after all this, you know, and I made some money, but it was just like somebody slapping you across the face and knocking you down. Next, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm saying, wow, you know, I was so dedicated, and I gave 100% of myself. So I decided to go to school at junior college to study music because I figured I need some kind of musical background because one time when I was on tour, Gene Pitney was singing. He says to the guys, "Hey, somebody's playing a B flat and should be a B natural." And I said, "Here, you know, I'm doing this stuff and I'm, what are you talking about?" I said, "Oh no, it's a whole different caliber of my, you know, the guys that I'm, these guys, you know, they know what the heck music's all about." That's why I decided to go to school and study. And so then I pursued studying music and it was hard. And then a friend of mine says, "Hey, so Zeke," he said, "I'm going to this company." He was a great saxophone player. His name was Bob, and Bob Tate. And so we went, and this guy comes on and says, "Hey, Bob, this is good. I heard your tunes. I can't use them," he said. "Can't use any of them." I said, "Okay." He said, "Okay." He said, "By the way, this is Chris Montez," out of his mouth, you know, just like. And the guy says, "You're Chris Montez, a singer?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm going to school." He says, "Would you like to record again?" I said, he said, "I'd like to have you for my company." And I said, "I'm not interested. I don't want to record anymore." And he said, "Well, think about it." And that was Herb Alpert, the Tijuana Brass. I became a producer. Can you believe that?
Yeah, I can believe it.
And I said,
A&M Records.
A&M Records. I said, "Oh, okay." So I went with a staff producer, And I was doing Let's Dance kind of things. I was playing harmonica, I was doing a rock and roll. And then the staff producer was Marshall Lieb. He was
in the Hollywood Art Gals.
He was one of the singers of that, you know. Wonderful man, wonderful person. So he comes in and says, Herb doesn't like what we're doing. I said, oh, no. I said, not again. I'm out of here, you know. After, you know, I didn't want to get involved in this because, you know, I thought. He says, he's got an idea for you. And I said, he wants you to come in his office. So I go in and say, Herb's probably one of the coolest guys you ever want to meet. He's slick, he dresses cool. He looks Latin, he's not Latin. He's got all the moves and he's a very well-versed in music and theory. Not theory, but in grooves, you know. And the trumpet player that he is. And he said, I got an idea for you. And he goes, if you feel sad and lonely, there's a service I can render. And I said to myself, you must be kidding me. I said, I can't sing. That's for like Darren's and, you know, Sinatra. They're the hip singers, you know, the mature singers. I'm not there yet, you know. And to make a long story short, next thing I'm in the studio, I went along with what he said, and he's standing next to me in the studio, and he's saying, okay, come on. I'm saying, if you feel it, he's right there going. And he said, that's it. Yeah. He first set up the groove with the drummer. Hey, guys, I want to do this and that. And no, change that. He tells the drummer, change this. Give me that kind of groove. And he's always a tap, 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 you know, that kind of stuff. And so we recorded, and that was the beginning of A&M. I mean, that song got A&M going, and the Tijuana Brass was their first song.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Lonely Bull and all that.
Yeah,
that album,
yeah. And it was funny because that started that whole realm with Herb Alpert. And then I did all the standards, you know, every standard there was, you know.
You were singing
Fly Me to the Moon, How High the Moon, The Shadow of Your Smile, you know.
You even did some Little Anthony stuff.
Well, I think I'm going out of my head.
And
time after time, hear me say that I'm young. And that started that whole round. And so I was doing TV and doing all this. When that whole album was selling, I got a call. They wanted me to come to Brazil because it was a big hit. Oh, I thought maybe a song was a hit. And I said, yeah, you know, a new venture. So I took some guys with me, my band players, and we practiced for a while. And we got there, and when the plane landed, in fact, even the pilot asked me, said, you're Chris Montez, will you mind singing on the
intercom over
intercom,
the plane?
Intercom, yeah. Yeah, so I sang a few bars, you know. And the kids were all clapping, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And so when we landed, I look out there, and I see thousands of people. I thought, well, somebody's important on this plane. Because I'm, you know, no thing. And when I get down, there's a big sign, you know, big paper sign that says, welcome, Chris Montez.
Wow.
I couldn't believe it. I said, you've got to be kidding. It's like, it puts a smile on your face, and you're saying, wow, what a shocker this is.
Mm-hmm.
I just went through that routine with the Beatles, you know. And so I had 5 bodyguards. It's ridiculous. I had police escort, couldn't go nowhere. Had a great big suite on overlooking Ipanema Beach. You know, how cool can that be? You know? Yeah. I got married and, you know, had twin boys and a girl.
Is that right? You got 3 kids and twin boys?
One shot, you know. Next thing, you know, I'm changing diapers and I always...
Oh my God.
I did that whole
did
shot.
Did you wash your hands?
I don't remember when I washed them anymore. No, but I went through that whole routine, and I went through a divorce, and then I recently got married again, and I got a 17-year-old daughter, and 2 daughters, really, one's older than her. But during those times, remember, I fell out of the music industry, and when I went through this breakup with my ex, it was devastating to me, because I would say that I was to blame for it, you know. And... being the young macho man that I wasn't, you know, Mr. Cool, you know, womanizer, you know, and...
you couldn't handle the fame and all that attention.
Well, it wasn't the fame, it was just, you know, it was new to me, you know. When you're in high school, you're starting to, trying to get girlfriends, and all of a sudden you got girlfriends hanging on you.
Yeah.
You know? So it changes everything. and then I got married, and this before, after this whole thing, and but now it's all settled, and I've been around the block a few times, and I've studied a conservatory of music in Sunland, and I studied jazz for at a jazz school for about 3 years, and I first started studying classical guitar, pieces like Villa-Lobos, which are beautiful pieces, and Derrida, you know, and just to learn to read music, and that took me a while. And now I would say to all of you that are trying to get a former education in anything you seek is to get a foundation, because I'm so glad I got a foundation. It doesn't mean that I'm a better player, but it means that I'm better equipped, you know, to do what I have to do.
And you have a greater appreciation now for how you got to be where you are.
Yes, and I'm glad I did it, you know, even with hardships and growing up in a poor family. But with the grace of the Lord, with the grace of God, he was always there for me. And I would do it again. I wouldn't change mother or father or where I was, you know, what kind of home I lived, because that's what makes us all strong, where we come from. That's our roots. And if we enjoy our roots and enjoy life that way, there's a true blessing.
And through all that you've done and all you've accomplished, here we are at this, you know, at this age, still walking upright, still up on stage.
Yeah,
you're still performing.
Yeah.
And you're going to be performing tonight.
Yeah, I'm going to be performing. I'll be singing like La Bamba and Donna and The More I See You and Call Me. And
Let's Dance?
Let's Dance, of course.
Okay.
Yeah.
And a little bit of Freddie Fender.
A Freddie Fender tune.
Thrown in.
You know, and Carlos Santana, you know, Black Magic Woman.
Okay.
It's going to be good. It's going to be a great
show.
Can we
come? Can we all come?
Yes, please.
All right, I'm going to bring the camera and all my friends, all right?
No, leave the camera at home.
Well, then I got to stay home too. Okay.
I would like to tell you from the bottom of my heart that it takes a lot of dedication and a lot of love for what you want to do in life, and don't let any obstacles overthrow you. But if you're not, I'm not going to preach to you, but I'm saying with God, if you have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, as your foundation, you can accomplish anything. And the bottom line, if you do accomplish it, you'll be happy. You won't have an empty space in your life, and that's where I'm at.
You've never had emptiness from what I know.
Well, I've been lonely, but and I needed strength, but that's where I got it.
I appreciate it, buddy. Let's get you up on stage.
Okay.
My oldest brother brought a friend home, and they both had guitars, and they started playing that. That must have been about 8 or 7. And I said, wow, that's a great song. Play it again. They played it again. I never heard it again until I heard Ritchie Valens do it. Yeah. Yeah. Isn't that true? It's something else.
Yeah, it is.
It's just it's got a good riff, you know. It's easy to relate to.
I see you over here. He's making tea here for his honey.
That's
class.
That's nice.
It's hot. It's what it is.
Oh well, I'll take over here.
First to make the
That first
sound
all right? It felt pretty good.
Oh, it's a bumper? Yeah.
No, with Jimmy.
Oh, that was sounded great.
Yeah.
You guys,
yeah,
felt good.
The smell
was very nice.
Good. Yeah. Hey, Hollywood. You just, he had the shot.
Yeah, I think those were.
No, Marty,
you might do the 20-minute version of La Bamba.
Yes. And that's it.
Right.
Last year drop.
And that's it.
Right.
Big tunes.
There's Vince. He's sick as a dog.
Yeah.
Uh oh.
Yeah. He looks like a dog.
Yeah, everyone's like big sick dog.
Yeah.
We're all sick with this darn cold.
Oh, here we have about 2 minutes. You all stay away from me.
Yeah.
Me too.
So we have what?
So
25 minutes before the song? Well, it's an honor to play with you guys. You know, it's a pleasure. I really enjoy it. Thank you very much for your support, because you know.
You should wait until we actually do this.
No.
It may not be so good, you know?
Well, come on, let's go. I love you.
I see all the Just